very good morning to you. This online service, in a way, is going to take the shape of Food, Faith and Fun, our new evening service on Sundays. Today's service in the evening has been cancelled because of all the uncertainty and anxiety with weather, so we're shifting Food, Faith and Fun to this edition of our online service. Enjoy. And be aware that our next on Food, Faith and Fun will take place in a fortnight, where the Year 6 people of our school will come and challenge us with a theme built around Jesus' challenge to serve. Well, good morning. Look, I know this is a bit of a strange place to have a camera set up, but the thing is, this week held for us Ash Wednesday. Ash Wednesday is a very significant day in our year. It marks the beginning of a 40-day journey that leads to Easter and Good Friday. Anyway, this week I spent a reasonable amount of time asking people to think about ashes, and actually took a pile of ashes around to some classrooms where students, I asked them to think about Ash Wednesday by staring at some ashes. Well, here, you're looking into my chiminea, and as I looked at some ashes here left over from last winter's fires. The thing is, when you look at ashes, you're looking at the leftovers of what happens when a fire has consumed everything there. The fire has done its thing, and the ashes, that's what's left over.
There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle and makes his home. Light your world.
as we've thought about ashes, and the deeper you look into a pile of ashes, the more you might think about what it was that has burnt. This lump of wood here was a living thing before the fire got hold of it and destroyed it. A lump of wood that was alive. And the more you look at that and think about it, the more sadness will come into this picture. It's sad to think about what this piece of wood was. And I think that's where the Christian tradition of marking themselves with some ashes, I think that's where it comes from. The idea of ashes to ashes, dust to dust, it's a sad expression. And it gets us thinking then about, another part of the sadness of Christ's story. Because on Ash Wednesday, 40 days before Good Friday, we take some time to listen to Jesus as we relive his story. But there came a moment with his disciples, those who were following him, where he said to them, "Do you realize where all of this is going?" And so he chose a critical moment where he talked to them about the cross, and that's the place he was planning to go. And so we have that reading from Mark chapter 10, verse 32. They were on the road going up to Jerusalem. Jesus was walking on ahead of them. They were in a daze, and those who followed were apprehensive. Once more taking the 12, he began to tell them what was going to happen to him. And he said, "Now we're going on up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man is about to be handed over to the chief priests and the scribes. And they will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the chief priests and the scribes. And they're going to condemn him to death and hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit at him, flog him and kill him. 3 days later, he will rise again." So that's a challenge we place ourselves in at this moment, to see ourselves in that picture. And Jesus confronts us with the place that he's going to. And as he makes his way to the cross of Good Friday, he makes it absolutely clear to you and me. He says, will you come with me? I'm going that way. Will you follow me to that place where his life will be given for him?
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings of the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me.
Ashes and having talked about their meaning, the most significant part of my week then was that moment where we asked people whether they'd like to receive a mark of ash in the shape of the cross, just to give meaning to this moment, to help people remember, and then to look ahead to the cross that is waiting for Jesus on Good Friday, some 40 days or so away from us right now. The theme we had planned for our food, faith and fun Sunday at 5 service this Sunday evening, it was going to be about the empty egg. We wanted to do a few things to help people get ready for Easter. And given that that was our theme, that's led me to present you with this following little episode from Douglas Talks. And you'll see that this definitely is a way of a thought to get you ready and prepared for Good Friday and Easter.
Jesus can really help me put things in perspective. Hey guys, it's me again, Douglas, and at my church we always have an Easter egg hunt at Easter. Yeah, so in between the services, we have all the kids go out and we hunt all the eggs that the adults were hiding. And people bring eggs and then they go out and hide them. And then us kids go and find them. And it's a really fun time. You know, it's just a fun tradition. And I don't know who, but somebody brings these eggs that are there, 5 silver eggs and 1 golden egg. And the 5 silver eggs have $1 in them, a dollar bill, real money. But the 1 golden egg has $5 in it. And this year, really quickly, right after the Easter egg hunt started, I found the golden egg. I found the egg with $5 in it, and I was so excited. I put it into my basket, and I put it right in this little spot where where I could see it in my basket. You know, I could see it easy, but it would not fall out of my basket because I didn't want to drop it. And at the end of the Easter egg hunt, I go and I look into my basket, and it's not there. And right about that time, I hear this kid a ways away, somebody I didn't know, you know, someone who, like, he was somebody's grandkid or somebody. You know, he was, like, visiting for Easter. And this kid, I hear him say, "Look, I found a golden egg with $5 in it." And I was so mad. Oh my goodness, you don't even know. Because I know he took it. Because there was a time where I put my basket aside for a second. I left it out in the open and I climbed up in a tree so that I could get an egg that I saw up there. And so that's when he must have taken it. I know it didn't fall out because I put it in my basket really safe so it wouldn't fall out. That kid definitely stole my egg. And oh my goodness, I was so mad. I wanted to do something bad. I wanted to go and bring justice on his head, or, you know, I don't know. Just, I was so mad. But, you know, we were out in the, you know, like the yard by our church, and there's like a little garden out there. And in that garden, you know, there's a little garden out there, and in that garden, there's a cross. And when I looked at that cross, all of that anger and frustration just disappeared. Because I remembered what we celebrate on Easter. You know, Jesus died for our sins and he rose again from the dead, but in order to rise again from the dead, he had to die for our sins. And people were really, really mean to him. They tortured him. They killed him. And in the middle of all that, you know, Jesus is hanging there on the cross and he's dying, literally dying. And he looked down at the people who were killing him and he said, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." And man, when I thought of that, my little golden egg seemed so silly. Because in all reality, it is. Just an Easter egg hunt. And yeah, that kid totally stole my egg, but I've also sinned. God sent his son Jesus to die for my sins, for your sins, for all of our sins, for that kid who stole my egg, for his sins. And that's what's really most important. So here's my challenge to you guys today. My challenge to you guys is that next time you get really mad because somebody did something mean to you, I want you to think about the cross. I want you to think about Jesus. I want you to think about what Jesus did for you. And for the person who was mean to you. He died for us. And if we accept that free gift, we get to live with God forever in heaven because of what Jesus did. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, so that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him.
Speaking of crosses, there's a little project that we've set for ourselves here at St. Paul's. Between now and Easter, if you should visit our church or attend a service there, you'll see that everyone's invited to bring along a favourite little cross. I'm bringing this cross. It has a special memory for me back in the day when I was at Sandgate, my first place, my first parish to serve in. Some years after I left there, Sandgate closed as a church community and merged with Petrie to become what is now Living Faith at Murrumba Downs. But one of the old pews at Sandgate, some gentleman cut it up and made everyone who had belonged there a little cross. This is one of them, made from the seats of that church. This cross is special to me. Maybe there's a cross that you have that has a story behind it that makes it special. You're welcome to bring it to St. Paul's and to place it alongside the crosses that other people bring. To let that be a part of our Lent picture this year. God bless your worship. Lord Jesus Christ, we know in our hearts that following you, discipleship, demands an utterly new way of seeing people, just like you did, and being with them unconditionally as you were. But the journey from heart to eyes and hands and feet can be long and difficult. We're sorry that we find it especially difficult to remember that loving you takes priority over everything and everyone else in our lives. Forgive our reluctance to proclaim with our lips and our lives that you are Lord. You are Lord of our lives. We confess that we prefer our journeys of faith to be devout, but not too daring, comfortable, and not too threatening. Forgive our fear of treading your way of obedience, the way of the cross. Lord Jesus Christ, give us the grace to trust in the unknowing nature of your call to each of us, and the unknown direction which you call us to travel. You have traveled the road already, so what do we have to fear? Jesus, our Lord, we do want to be your followers so that we can reveal through our lives, as you did, the shape of God's unconditional love. May we be filled, renewed, and guided by the Holy Spirit so that we commit ourselves anew to the challenge of following you, serving and loving others in his name and for his sake. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are all yours, now and always. Amen.